Good evening. Myself, Parag Yelegaonkar. I am heading business development in Testo India Private Limited, and I also look after the projects in Testo. Basically, Testo is a German company, and we have headquarter in Lenzkirch and TTZ in Germany, which is in Black Forest. We have 32 subsidiaries spread all across the world, and we also have India as a major largest subsidiary. And we also have a network in India for our channel partners, dealers, and associates. Basically, I will be covering after first we saw the finance and viability part of it, then we saw asset management, O&M, and now we will see little technology part, how we can find out the defects in solar from the cell manufacturing up to the plant and project level. So basically, this is a solar cell structure, the cut section, where you can see the aluminum frame, seal, glass, EVA, and Tedler film. This is a typical structure. Then this is a typical view of a solar power plant outside, and where we generate the power. This is basically a polycrystalline solar power plant. Here, I would like to emphasize on the thermal imaging usages to find out the defects in the solar cell as well as module, defects in the junction box, array junction box, and the inverter of the solar power plants, and also after inverter, this is the transformer, and up to the transmission line where we are feeding the power. So basically, it's an infrared technology. Whenever there is an object, it always emits electromagnetic radiations, and those radiations are absorbed by the IR sensors in the thermal imaging camera, and it can be detected any hotspots, cold spots, defects in all these components, electrical, mechanical components. We have different modules for solar photovoltaic system defect detection. We have important model is 885, where the thermal sensitivity is just 30 millikelvin, so that a minute temperature differences in solar module cells can be identified for the defects as far as the hotspots are concerned and the cold spots are concerned. These are the typical views, how you can see here the hotspots, how you can detect in a module, and whenever you see the hotspots, you can take a thermograph and do the analysis in the IR software that we provide along with the thermal imaging camera. Please note that whenever you do the thermography on any solar power plant, it is better to do the thermography from the backside, because on the top there is a glass and any solar infrared radiations cannot pass through the glass. For that, typical germanium glass is required for the solar electromagnetic radiations to pass through. So preferably, if you find any defect from the top, just go behind the solar module and take another thermograph so that you can easily identify the defects. And you can also find out the accurate temperature when you do the thermography from the backside of the module. These are some typical thermograms. You can find out the patchwork pattern, defective bypass diode, delamination defects that also can be identified with thermal imaging. Then of course the cracks. This is the typical problem when we receive the solar modules from the transportation. There is always a possibility that there may be some cracks. Some cracks may be left out during the manufacturing and pre-dispatch. Those can be identified. This is a bird's eye view of solar power plant, wherein you can see the thermal images and the thermal patterns. Please note that whenever there is a dust problem in your solar modules, you will get a higher temperatures. So whenever you get a higher temperature pattern from the top, you can conclude that there is a lot of dust is accumulated on the solar modules, and the panel needs cleaning. And whenever you clean the panel, you can see the temperature changes. After cleaning, the temperature goes down. These are the summary of typical defects on the solar modules. This is again a junction box where there is a possibility of getting the hot connections due to corrosion, due to loose connections. So you can find it out in one look from the thermal imaging camera. This is a typical camera module we offer for the solar photovoltaic plant, where this particular thermal imaging camera has Wi-Fi and Bluetooth connectivity. With Bluetooth, it can connect the clamp meter, which measures AC-DC voltages and also AC-DC current, power, VA, VAR. So these parameters can be interfaced with the thermal imaging camera. When you take the image, all these parameters are recorded in the software, and also you can integrate thermohygrometer with this thermal imaging camera, so that you can also note temperature, ambient temperature and ambient humidity at the time when you take the thermal image. So this is a typical connections, Wi-Fi connectivity. This is a thermohygrometer and the clamp meter, which I already referred, the number of parameters you can interface. And all the parameters can be captured, and you can have a professional report within a minute, software generated, and the report can be sent from the site to your head office and to the concerned facility management people. These are the typical thermal images which we have taken from Dhule Solar Power Plant, 125 megawatt Mahajanko. You can see how the hotspots can be identified in the cells, and then the corrective actions can be taken. Either you can take out the module and replace it with a new module, so that it cannot damage the other modules in the same string or array. These are the typical problems in the
sensor box. Can I request for a last minute, please?
Also, there is a balance of plant equipments like transformer and connectivity to the grid. There also is a possibility of the hotspot, and you will lose the availability if it is not predicted earlier. That's all from my side. In case you have any doubt, you can ask me in the question answer session, and we have kept some of the instruments outside for the display. If you have any requirement or if you have a query, you can come back to me. Thank you.
Thanks very much. So I heard, Mukund, you don't have a presentation, but you can just represent your company.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Mukund Shendge. I am from Fronius, India. We are representing a premium inverter in string inverter technology. So our product portfolio is restricted to small commercial and industrial rooftop segment. So we are not catering to the multi-megawatt projects and central inverter category. Here there are few topics I just wanted to highlight. Since 2010, we have seen significant reduction in the project prices and the cost of levelized cost of electricity. This decrease from 20 crores to today 4.5 crores per megawatt is creating immense pressure on component manufacturer to reduce the cost. So this is in turn it is good for an industry to flourish. However, it is very important to know, what component suppliers have to do with the reliability and the quality of the product. So it's very important. This pressure is getting transferred to increase the capacities of the inverters to cope up with the required project prices and all. But end of the day, we have a lot of presentations today to understand the performance of the plant. For example, Vamanju also given a lot of presentations on how you track the performance levels of the particular plant. But we, as of now, do not have any analytical tool to understand failure of a particular performance level because of selection of wrong component in the project over the long term. For example, if you choose some wrong inverter instead of using reliable quality inverters, so what would be the impact of the generation? What could be the impact on the losses created by shedding? Of course, the derating is also an important factor, because a lot of times to cope up the price requirements from the project, we have to do a lot of overloading, not from the technical point of view, but to compensate the project pricing, right? So all these things are resulting into somewhere somewhere it is not going good sense to consider the long project life of 20 to 25 years for the end users, right? So we have to understand and consider what is important today to consider into the projects. So that's one thing. And apart from that, there's a regulation which is also giving a lot of emphasis on improving our grid standards. There's a distributed generation regulation from CEA 2012, and which is getting amended with newer clauses every year. However, it is very important to understand, if we are talking about interconnecting distributed generation plant to any industrial or commercial rooftop, what should be the quality of the grid, right? So this is often getting ignored, and a lot of plants, even if they are performing well in developed countries, they're not able to perform in grid conditions like Indian grid conditions, for example. So that is also has to be addressed in long run. Yeah, and of course, one of the major performance criteria for inverters is also derating, apart from efficiency. So derating is something what is to protect inverters from higher temperature stresses. So it has been managed to reducing the output power of the inverter by triggering the current limit function, which is again a function of MPPT in the inverter. So we have different possibilities to look at the derating aspects of the particular inverter. For example, you can compensate the derating factor into efficiency measurement, or you can separately state it in your data sheet. There are two techniques actually, but at the end, it's very important. These kind of things are there to protect the inverter, and the core component and the architect of the inverter has to decide what approach he has to select. For example, he will not show derating and show the effect in the efficiency curve, or he separately shows the efficiency impact and derating impact, and work on the firmware settings within the inverter. So these are the two things. Just wanted to be clear on this aspect. I just wanted to talk about these aspects, and thank you very much. Thanks.
Thanks, Mukundji. I think it is really brave of you to speak without slides for 5-7 minutes. So can I invite the next speaker to carry on the session?
Good afternoon, everyone. So my presentation will briefly cover about our company and our association with the solar industry, and also a bit of challenges that we are facing because of the evolving the nature and the fast changes in the industry which is happening, solar industry. So Aelius is a brand. First of all, Tata BlueScope Steel is an equal joint venture between Tata Steel India and BlueScope Steel Australia. What Tata Steel is in India is the same what BlueScope Steel in Australia, and we have under our fold is the list of brands which are over 100 year old brands: Zinc Alum, Color Bond, Lysat, and Visible. And we take cold rolled steel CRFH from Tata Steel. We using the technology of BlueScope Steel Australia for painting and coating. We manufacture color coated coils or zinc alum coils, which are roll formed into different profiles. And Lysat is a history, like 1857, Mr. John Lysat started the operation in England and expanded to Australia, and later on Broken Hill Properties took it over, and that's how it became part of BlueScope Steel Australia. And I'll skip some slides. And how we contributed in solar industry was, when we entered in this industry a couple of years back, those days the structures, the ground mounted structures were majorly made out of HR steel, which are hot dip galvanized, and they are heavy structures, and that time when we, and they were hot, they are heavy structures, and they were welded at the site, and the operations were a bit unsafe. So we happened to have an association with the company wherein we tried to promote pre-galvanized structures. These are cold form sections which are much thinner in sections, and also zinc alum we have recently started that also, which brought down the weight drastically. The structure which used to weigh around 80 tons a megawatt couple of years back has come down to almost 26 tons a megawatt. And secondly, the working, there's no welding required at the site. It is all nut bolted. They come in the pre-punch hold from the factory. They are factory cut, and this is very easy to assemble there when we're talking of the ground mounted structure. So the end customer, what he gets is a cost optimization, weight optimization, ease in installation, and much safer operation at the site. And when if we talk about rooftop mounted structures, there are two kind of structures. One is the concrete roof, or concrete roof again, these are the kind of ground mounted structure. We need to have a structure for which you need to have PV cells. We can also have pitched roof. You can have pitched roof of maybe old sheds of asbestos sheets or color coated sheet itself, where we also have the expertise to dismantle and re-roof it again. And we, all the profiles are compatible to have, or they are all we have developed special clamps which can take PV cells over it, straight over it. So we have got different kind of profiles. These profiles are more popular profiles, trapezoidal profiles, which are screwed on profiles. And these are the concealed, these are the premium profiles. And this is a picture we have taken from Daimler, Chennai, where we have used this premium profile, for which these PV cells were directly put using the specially developed clamps. And this is in detail, we have shown how it is fixed. Over the profile, the clamps fit, and over this, the PV cells come. And the ground mounted structure or the rooftop structures also, where the concrete roof is there, we normally use either cold form sections or zinc alum sections made out of zinc alum sheets. And they are either C or Z sections or the hat sections, depending upon the kind of structures you have got. This is again a picture taken for ground mounted structures. And the way it is installed, you can see how easily the person is installing at the site. The construction is very fast, it's very safe. And safety, I've just tried to capture some of the safety gears that we use. This is what I was talking about, the sections. Basically, these are the two sections which we use, C sections, Z sections. They reduce the weight almost 30 to 40% as compared to your conventional steels. But still it is catching up, it is still not not acceptable in the industry, it's still evolving. And along with the, Tata BlueScope Steel is also known for some of the good practices we inculcate in the, or we try to bring awareness about this in the industry. Recently we were awarded with the Vishwakarma Award by CEIDC because of our high norms or high standard of safety. So for all each and every sections, we also try to educate how the material has to be stored at the site, what is the correct way of storing it, because these are very challenging sites. These are open sites, you do not have shelters so easily there. And scheduling is also not very accurate. And many times the components that we send to the site, they are there for a couple of weeks and months. So along with that, we give the guidelines how it has to be handled. And the challenges which we are facing now is, the biggest challenge is the dropping or the falling tariffs. What is resulting into is, the falling tariff is resulting into high, we are losing price competitiveness in the market. So what is, all the quality suppliers and manufacturers, they're finding it difficult to invest in this kind of scenario. Also the steep, because of steep increase in the risk and uncertainty involved, again the investments that we try to make, or we try to think increasing in this business also is, we are finding it not very, attractiveness is not there in this segment. Out of our total business, almost this business, solar segment constitutes only 15% or so. Even though we are very keen to invest more in this, but because of this falling tariff, it is a big, you can say, constraint for us. So this is a small presentation from this.
Thank you very much. Yeah, can I request you to have your session as well?
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Geetanjali. I'm CEO and co-founder of Energy Guru. We have been in solar business for last more than 10 years. This is 11th year running. We have been assisting many international solar developers with consulting, international advisory, as well as financing. And while we're doing that, we actually embarked on few innovative ideas and have been manufacturing those. One of them is an industrial solar boiler that we intended to actually integrate that into thermal power plants. And then another thing that we have worked on is a solar drying for agriculture sector. And this is one of the third idea that we have been working on is the waterless robotic solar module cleaning system. I would like to talk about, you know, what is the need for waterless cleaning systems and again, what are the effects of water on solar modules, talk about our technology and maybe, you know, take some of your questions. So if you look at, you know, globally, I think the soiling losses vary from anywhere from 0.5 to 1% per day, depending on which part of, you know, the world you are, as well as which part of city you are. And currently, there is almost 7,000 to 20,000 liters, and even in some cases, even it's higher, liters of water is used per megawatt per wash, which is quite high. And I think one of the reasons that we have worked on this robotic module cleaning system is not because of, you know, we were driven by the, you know, for making the solar power developers more money, but I was personally involved in assisting many widows of the farmers who committed suicide last 3 years in Marathwada. And we know that majority of these solar power plants that we're installing are in the arid regions. And it's criminal to use water when there is hardly any water for farming and farmers are committing suicide. And that was the key driver for us. And of course, like while we're doing that, of course, the developers are going to be benefited. And I think, you might have already seen this. Majority of you have already been using water for washing. 15 gigawatt is already installed, and I am assuming majority of it is all water-based washing. May I ask you to raise your hands? Whoever has explored, you know, robotic solar module cleaning systems at their plants or waterless cleaning methods? Hardly any, right? So this shows that, you know, pretty much we have gone after installing solar power plants without thinking whether there is water in India or not. So for to wash solar modules, there are definitely guidelines in terms of what pressure the water needs to be, you know, water pressure needs to be applied, what is the pH value, what is the, you know, salt concentration. And there's a lot of rules around that, but hardly anybody, I don't know how many of us are actually using that one. Okay, so that means that, again, we are definitely, again, creating adverse effect on the modules because of the kind of water standard that we're using. Now, I think coming back to waterless robotic solar module cleaning system, so I think you might have seen some pictures already, but so there are a variety of systems are available in the market. And I think one of the pictures that was shown recently by Ujas was one on the truck. So those are also robotic, but then again, those can be truck driven as well. Then there are robots that can actually go on the module frame itself. Okay, so they don't need separate rails. And there are certain systems that are that actually need a specialized rails to be put in to be able to install their systems. And then there are drone-based systems as well. I'm not going to show the pictures because I knew that we have many of us need to speak, so I don't have too many pictures that I'm going to share, but I will only talk about what we have got to offer here. So I think why do we need robotic cleaning is not, human intervention, you know, so that is going to cause some deaths because we are talking about, you know, water and DC current. So electrocution risk is there. Then of course we are talking about very harsh currents where it is difficult for human beings to work. So we need to be cognizant about that. And also, if we were to talk about water trucks, it's like it's not like America, you know, we don't have those many, that much infrastructure available for washing. Hence, we put in few design thinking when we actually came up with this product. So we thought that this product must go on existing installation. 15 gigawatt is already installed, 300 around the world. So it needed to go on the existing installations because there are products in the market that actually only target the new installations because they need the rails. But we actually can go on the existing installations. Then we needed to save water, so this is needed to be waterless. It needed to be lightweight. I wanted to ensure that even I can lift on one side and another person on another side. So it's very lightweight because it's a rugged system that needs to be very lightweight as well because we don't want to hurt the modules. Then brush should not be abrasive. Somebody talked about ARC coating. The ARC coating cannot be, you know, we cannot put abrasive brushes on the solar modules so that, you know, the ARC coating is protected. Many of us are not actually taking care of that, and that needs to be taken care of. And also this needed, to, because we are a very cost-conscious country, and if we were to sell these systems, it has to be very modular, and it has to be very, people can choose how many they want to buy, rather than making, one robot per module. So it needed to be easily moved from one place to another one. So I think the first and foremost thing is, you know, how do we take care of the module surface? Because everybody wants to ensure that we are not hurting the modules. So we actually started with emu feathers. Emu feathers are the softest one. Those are usually used in Mercedes-Benz or BMW. Before they paint it, they actually clean it with emu feathers, and then eventually they get painted. So we actually started with that, and then of course we have worked with many materials, and finally we have embarked on few materials that would work for modules and of course the heavy duty cleaning that we need to do. So I think we already talked about this. This is one of the, so there are two ways to throw the dust. One is we throw the dust down along the gravity, and another way is to do, throw the dust sideways in the gaps of the solar modules. So we have got almost three systems actually. So this is our horizontal brush system, which actually pushes the dust down. It laterally moves, pushes the dust down, it laterally moves, and that's how the cleaning is done. And these are some specifications of the system. This is a vertical brush system. This actually just, it's quite speedy, and it just pushes the dust on the sideways in the gaps. And also if you have blockages in terms of dust, if you cannot push the dust down, then you can always choose it to go in the sideways and push it in the gaps. Okay, so this is another vertical brush system. This is specs. Also, we have got another system that is a slant brush system, which will actually move laterally and push the dust down and sideways at the same time. So it's doing the, it's taking care of the gravity as well as it's taking care of the speed as well in cleaning. This is one of the pictures. Now, the developers do not want to put the human beings on the ground. Okay, so that was another requirement that one of the big, very big developer that wanted us to develop is to not make two people lift the system from one row to another one. Suppose we have one robot that is very modular. So we still needed people to move from one row to another one. So they said, okay, why don't you come up with a train or something that would take the duster from one row to another one. So we had developed that robotic docking train. So the robot cleans the solar panel, it will go on the robotic train, the train will carry to the next row, then it will again go back to the next row cleaning.
So last minute for you, please.
Yeah, so this is a robotic train that can carry actually from row to row. These are the rails that are very portable that actually can we can actually implement. And how many robots are needed? So this is a typical installation that we have shown. Two per megawatt is what we recommend for an alternate day cleaning based on the speed of this robot. So this particular system is completely can be controlled by cloud. We have Zigbee on each robot as well as on the docking train as well. And a 50 megawatt of power plant can be actually controlled from cloud itself. And we have an analytics piece that can actually give you information on the soiling losses. If you give us the generation data, then we can actually compare and give the alerts to you. These are some of the dashboards that are out there. That will be helpful for you to understand what is going on with the generation and the soiling. This is our team. We are based in Pune, by the way. This particular product is completely indigenously developed in India, including the controller and everything. Again, coming back to what parameters you should be thinking in terms of robotic cleaning, whether you want to go with water or waterless is the first question, whether this particular area has enough water. Then how frequently you want to clean. So depending on that, you want to actually choose the number of robots, because it is a modular system, you can just move from one row to another one. Then labor availability. So I think I talked about this robotic train that can, you, if you don't have labor, that you don't want to deploy some labor on the ground, then you can always choose some other other solutions as well. Then the cost of the equipment, how much money you want to spend on that. And of course, there is a perception that robots are very expensive, but not necessarily. I can definitely talk about that if you have any questions. And infrastructure changes, because existing plants cannot make infrastructure changes to accommodate the robots. So that's one of the reasons our system like ours, which can actually go on the solar modules itself, will be very helpful for you to not to think about infrastructure changes. Thank you so much, and look forward to helping you out if need be.
Thank you very much for your presentation.